Though the tears may fall, my song will rise, my song will rise to you. Though my heart may fail, my song will rise to you. While there's breath in my lungs, I will praise you, Lord. In the dead of night, I'll lift my eyes to you. Though the waters rise, I'll lift my eyes to you. While there's hope in this heart, I will praise you. Cannot see you with my eyes, let faith arise in you. When I cannot feel
Your will be done, so that everything Good morning, Harvest KL. Welcome to our service of worship. My name is Dan, and I'm part of the elder team here. Welcome to our last service of 2020. Let's turn our hearts now to worship the Lord.
Let earth receive Together this morning. I love the lines in that second verse that said, "The God who comes to save is here to set the captives free." And that's what we get to celebrate at Christmas, that Jesus came to save us and to redeem the world of its brokenness. I love this weekend. I love this celebration that we get to have. I'm going to give you guys just a couple minutes if you guys would like to greet one another. As we all gather around our screens at home, just say hi in the chat below or get out your phones and WhatsApp someone and just make their morning by saying hey.
Thank you. Hey church, good morning. Thank you so much for joining us here once again this morning. My name is Gurpreet and I'm part of the team here at Harvest KL. If you're new with us, let us know that you're here. Say hi to us in the chat or fill in the connect card. You can find the connect card on the chat feature right now. Go ahead and click on that link, fill up as much information as you feel comfortable, write in a prayer request. We would love to hear from you in terms of what your prayer requests are and lift those prayer requests up to the Lord as we go about our week. In fact, if you've been with us for quite a number of years or quite a number of time, please make your prayer request known to us as well. We really believe in the power of prayer and seeking the Lord in faith to accomplish the work that we need help in dependence upon Him. I'm also going to take the next couple of minutes just to share some of the announcements that are going on here at Harvest KL. Just one actually this week, so it's pretty short and simple and brief. There will be no small groups the following week, so we're going to take a break from small groups this coming week, but we are also lining up and planning and trying to conceptualize what small groups are going to look like in 2021, particularly for the first quarter of the year. So in January, we're going to be meeting. We haven't decided on the particulars yet. We'll be meeting once a week for a time of just engagement and connection as well as prayer. So it's going to be a one-hour session. We don't have all the details ascribed to it yet, but as we go about this coming week, we'll firm those things up and be in communication with your small group leaders so that they can disseminate those details to you as we look into moving on in small groups in 2021. I just say thank you quickly since you're bearing with a lot of the uncertainties. I really appreciate your ability to kind of be flexible in that, and we encourage you to continue to plug into your small group and just love on your members and be the body of the body of Christ that God has called us all to be. All right, so we're going to transition back into a time of worship. So let me just pass you guys back to the worship team as they lead our hearts to that place.
joyful we adore you, God of glory, Lord of love. Hearts unfold like flowers before you, opening to the sun above. Melt the clouds of sin and sadness, drive the dark of doubt away.
To us a child is born, to us a son is given, and the government shall be upon his shoulders. And his name shall be called Wonderful Counselor, Mighty God, Everlasting Father, Prince of Peace. She will give birth to a son, and you are to give him the name Jesus, because he will save his people from their sins.
What a beautiful name it is. Well, that was a beautiful song. What a beautiful name. And indeed, Jesus' name is beautiful. We're going to go into a time of corporate prayer now. Why don't we all close our eyes and bow our heads in prayer. Lord, we are thankful that your name is worthy and worthy of worship. And we are thankful, Lord, that your name brings hope to all of us. And as the new year looms, we just want to continue to bring this hope, Lord, to the new year. And we want to also pray, Lord, that you will help us transition into this new year, because there will be lots and lots of changes coming up. We know that the Newell family will be leaving us right after the new year, and we just want to commit them into your hands, Lord, that you will bring them home safely. And we also pray for the church and a transition that will take place in the church. There will be changes, but Father, we just pray that these changes will glorify you. Lord, COVID-19 has been the main topic of 2020, and it will continue to be at least in the coming months of 2021 as well. We want to ask, Lord, that you will empower the governments to make wise decisions for the nation. We also want to pray, Lord, for those who are separated from their family and who misses their family, especially in this time of celebration. We just want to pray comfort for their heart. We also recognize, Lord, that there have been those amongst us that has lost their jobs because of the COVID-19. We continue to uphold them, Lord, and pray that you will provide for their needs, Lord, and that you will meet them at every challenges that comes their way. Lord, you are faithful. We know, Lord, that you are faithful even when we are faithless. And we continue to pray and ask, Lord, for your presence to be with us even for the next year as well. So thank you, Lord, for being with us. Thank you, Lord, that you are a God that's worthy of worship, and that you Lord, you delight in providing us for all our needs. We just thank you for that. Pray in Jesus' name. Well, we're going to move into something a little different. Typically, we would have a sermon at this stage, but because this is Pastor Nate's last week with us, we're going to switch things around, and it's going to be in the form of an interview. And I'm just going to hand this over to Gupri for the interview. Thank you.
Hey church, as Shonga was mentioning, this week we're going to do our service slightly differently, particularly in the preaching of God's Word. We're going to have that done for us too. We're going to hear from God's Word, but that's coming. We just thought, since this week is the official last week for Pastor Nate and Marie and their family, we thought it was just a good idea to connect with them personally, to just kind of hear their heart out in terms of where they're at and what their hopes are for our church, so that we can continue to rally around them, but also be encouraged and learn from how God has actually led the both of them here at Harvest KL. So, hi, Pastor Nate, welcome.
Hey,
Murray, good to see you guys. Just a few questions to kick us off. We thought we'll do some engagement, lighthearted questions first initially as we start. But maybe tell us what led you to KL, and tell us a little bit about your decision about coming to KL.
Yeah, okay, so interesting. The way you asked the question, you asked my decision to come to KL. It was... the Lord was leading us just so clearly in the midst of all of that. And so I was happily pastoring a church that we had planted in 2008 called Oak Hill Fellowship Church in a little town in the state of Pennsylvania in the United States. We'd been there for about 7 years. And my prayer that particular year was that God would raise up a group of elders, more elders than what we had. That was actually something that was, I just felt like God wasn't really answering that prayer for a while. And then we went to a conference in Chicago that Harvest Bible Chapel put on, their big annual conference. And as we were there, God did actually change some hearts of some of the men to ultimately become elders, but he also redirected our lives completely. Using one of the sessions, they talked about a church in Kuala Lumpur that was in desperate need of a pastor, and that had joined Harvest, and they were praying that the man would even possibly be among the conference. It was a big conference, there was a couple thousand people there. And I'd been through all sorts of missionary calls as a missionary kid all before, so I'm pretty cynical to those types of things. And yet it was, I mean, the Lord really weighed on me heavy at that moment. It was like, you're the guy. And I'd been going through some discipleship material with some men at that point. And one of the things we did was we went through just our the story of our life and just saw how God had pieced things together. And God brought that to mind and was really using that in that moment, right in the middle of the conference, to really direct us to respond to. At the end of that session, they said, we'd love to hear from anybody who may be interested in this. And so I actually went and talked to the guy who had made the presentation. I hadn't even talked to Marie yet about that. She didn't know at all. And I just said, hey, if you need somebody for KL, I'd be interested in that conversation. And so we talked a little bit, exchanged information. Actually, I walked out of the session and I honestly thought that was God testing me. I just needed to be obedient. Right. Surely that's not going to happen. I'm not ready. My family's not ready. Our church isn't ready for a transition like this. Wow. And yet, as I went off to whatever seminar it was after that, the Lord was really stirring. And then later that day, I hadn't had a chance to talk to Marie at all about it. And we were in a car, just the two of us, between sessions. And Marie looked at me and she was like, do you have anything you need? Life-altering news.
Do you have any life-altering news you need to talk? I was making a joke.
Right.
You know?
But I did.
Yeah.
So you know that thing about Kuala Lumpur? I actually said I'd be interested.
You're probably like, why didn't I even ask that question? Right.
I thought she would throw me out of the car.
That's funny.
But she didn't.
I just said that if this is where God was leading, then I was all in, that we would do this.
And so for me, that was like, oh crap, that's for real. Yeah. Like that was my like, whoa, this is not just some test or something of that nature. This is something God's really doing. So I called the elder chairman, other spiritual leaders. We fasted and prayed. We went through a process. Actually, it was a number of months. We ultimately came, visited, interviewed. We thought the answer was no, from our side.
Yeah. Okay.
But then ultimately, God just kind of changed our hearts, and they invited us to come. And anyways, it was a long process. It took over a year before we were finally here. But January 1st, 2015 is when we landed, set foot on the ground in Malaysia, and began the process of that part. So interesting, you know, my decision. It really wasn't my decision. It was the Lord that was really leading us so clearly. In the midst of that, and yet we're so thrilled that he did.
Yeah, that's really cool to hear that. I think it's amazing to think that when God places that call upon our hearts, he also gives us the strength to kind of walk that out and trust him in the rest of the pieces as it comes together there.
Yeah.
Just follow up, what surprised you the most when you first came to KL? Was there anything that surprised you that caught you off guard? Or?
I think there were a lot of things that caught me off guard. It was my first time living overseas, But I think one of the things that surprised me so much was we came and the two family had already been here, and just the support and welcome and partnership that we had right away from them. And even just, you know, when we came into the airport at KL, we were greeted by like, you know, big welcoming committee. Andrew Tan was part of that.
Oh, cool.
You know,
he's like the first guy I met too, so he seems to be.
So it's just neat. I think God was giving us the beginning of lifelong friendships, so that's just cool. A gift. Yeah.
I just remember thinking that KL was so much more developed than what I remembered as a child growing up in Indonesia, and then going to high school in the Philippines and Manila, and I remember Asia 20 years previous, everything had grown up, and there were big highways and good infrastructure and.
And
clean
I had
water
to
drink.
I had to learn English again, British English.
Right. It's a different kind of English.
That's
great. That's good to know. It's good to hear everyone as a Malaysian that we are actually in right standing, actually developing into something great. So thank you for the compliments. What are some, what would you say is the best part of your journey as well as the more challenging parts of your journey? Could you share some of those?
Well, I think the best part is durian.
Yes.
Marie thinks that's the worst part.
I would say that's the challenging part.
Right. That's the most difficult part of being here.
Best part is for sure the durian.
Yeah.
And the worst part at the same time.
It's funny because our kids were even talking about how the challenging part for them when they came was the different kinds of food, and now it's totally like the best part.
Right, you know? That's funny.
That's
great. And just kind of leaning into that, so would you say there's some things that you didn't really enjoy coming in and then now you treasure? What would be some of those things? Like, I know food, you said, was one of those. Yeah. Or anything else that was kind of like that?
I think one thing that I struggled with a lot when we were first here and even in the first few years is just the transient nature of the city and our church, you know, just the constant rotation and that feeling of like, you're just getting to a spot where you're building momentum or have, you know, all the pieces in place as far as friendships or life and ministry, even in church. And then you get the news that someone's transitioning or they're leaving sooner than they thought. And thinking like just over and over again, being at that spot of like, Lord, you said you would build this church, but I feel like you're taking away the building blocks the time.
Yeah, that's hard.
And I think especially when we lost the Chu family, that was a time where I really wrestled with like, God, why are you writing the story this way?
Right.
You know? Yeah. But I mean, at the same part, like the same time, it is really hard, but I would not trade the, just the volume and diversity of relationships that we've received here, and just that picture of God spreading his people throughout the world, and you know, that he really does determine like the time and boundaries and places of where we live for his glory, for his name to be known. And I think for it really, a part that I treasure is the lessons of his goodness and faithfulness, that that he does build his church, that he knows the pieces we need and he'll move them into place as he sees fit. And it's not my story to write. So that's been a part that's both hard and treasured.
Yeah, I think too, like when we first got here, and this church was in a really bad, really bad place, really difficult place. Mm-hmm. They'd been without a pastor for a number of years, or for 18 months or so. There are a lot of tragic things that had happened beforehand. Just the condition of the body was in a really, really difficult,
broken place
in a sense. And so there was just a lot of hard, painful things. Mm-hmm. Particularly that first year, it was just pain after pain after pain. Yeah. it was a lot of difficulty. In the midst of that, we've seen just God do such an amazing work in the church. From a place that was really resistant to the Word of God being preached to a place that seems to love the Word of God being preached. And that's only something God can do. That has nothing to do with us. That's just the Lord and his work and changing hearts. And so I think, you know, just seeing those things, those are things that we love now. We it was hard, but we love it. And we wouldn't change the experience in that. And a lot of it because we've seen just God do such a powerful and amazing work. In this place, which is awesome. Yeah.
Well, thank you.
Yeah.
thank you for bringing God's word. I think that's important for all of us, and I think that's one of the things that encouraged me in my journey when I first came here. So thank you for being a faithful man of God.
Yep.
Really love you.
My privilege.
Really appreciate you both, of course. So just kind of reflecting back on your 6 years here in KL, what would you say is your fondest memory of being in KL?
That's a lot of memories, right?
I think I immediately see like people's faces, of course. And honestly, International Christmas is always a highlight.
Yeah,
but even just those snippets of like, I remember one Christmas service where we all came up on stage and we were talking about, or we were singing a song together, and there was a line in it about, basically, I can't remember the line of the song now, but it was God's word going out among the nations. Mm. And that's just been our experience in KL and Harvest KL. Mm. We get to worship with the nations, which is amazing.
I think for me, it'll just be multiple moments where we have seen just the word of God and the spirit of God ignite faith in the people, and just seeing people, maybe move from a moment of kind of a darkness of their understanding to the light of the truth of understanding. So it's not even always conversions. Sometimes it's even believers who suddenly see truth or the Lord in a new way. Mm-hmm. I think it's going to be those are the fondest memories, are the ones where those light bulb moments kind of happen. And
that's like, I mean, these are our real and honest responses, and they're the spiritual responses. But I'm thinking like, I mean, Malaysia is just a really fun place to live too.
Yeah.
We have a lot of fond memories.
Totally.
Absolutely. The beauty of Malaysia. So.
Yeah, people, the land.
Yeah, that's
great. Yeah, that's awesome. So if you were to sum up your whole 6 years worth of experience here into one word, Right? What would that one word be?
Yeah, it's faithful. And not our faithfulness, just God's faithfulness.
Yeah.
So when we so tell you the story about how we kind of heard the Lord's call to KL, and as we began to put together just our informing people, sending out notices and letters and different things of all that was happening, really we keyed in on a verse. We took a family picture with holding a board with 1 Thessalonians 5:24. 24. I think it's 24. Yeah. It says, "He who calls you is faithful; he will surely do it."
Right.
And
I've seen that photo actually in your house.
Yeah. So faithful is been the word, and I think that's such an important word, because even talking about some of the difficult and hard things, I thought, well, maybe endurance, maybe perseverance, maybe, but no, it's just his faithfulness over and over and over. And that we have seen God at work, God do the work, God do the thing, and even in moments that were the darkest and scariest, and where you seem most alone and most afraid and most devastated or things like that, like God just always came through. He has always been faithful to what he has called us to. And so I think that's such a good thing to remember, because sometimes it's hard to remember in the moment, when the crisis is kind of happening. And again, even just Harvest KL in the moment that we are all experiencing right now with our departure, like Jesus is the pastor of the church. Mm-hmm. He's the one who's faithful. I might not see around the corner of the obstacle, but he's the one who's going to do it.
Right.
And so faithful would have to be the word.
Yeah, that's a good word. So what are you looking forward most to when you get back to the U.S. besides, what's that chicken nugget place?
Oh, yeah, Chick-fil-A.
Chick-fil-A. Besides Chick-fil-A, because I always get that from Ella and Josiah.
It's God's chicken.
It's God's chicken, right?
Yeah.
Is there anything else besides Chick-fil-A that you're looking for? And Taco Bell, right? Not Taco Bell.
I am not looking for Taco Bell.
I love Taco Bell.
Other of us are.
Is there something you're looking forward to now that you're getting to go back to the U.S.?
That's hard, because honestly, we're still wrestling with what we're leaving. But one of the things that we have talked about, I'm sure our kids are looking forward to a lot of things that, don't make the list for me necessarily the same way. But one of the things we've talked about is just that we're looking forward to seeing how God uses everything we've seen and learned here. I'm looking forward to seeing how he writes the next chapter of our story. What that will be. I think that outweighs Chick-fil-A for me.
Right. Yeah. It is a really hard question to answer, because I'm not even sure that we're at a spot in the transition where we're even looking forward to anything.
Sure.
Yeah.
You know, like we're still feeling the loss of this, and we're trying to pack things up, and just all the it's just such a pain to transition all the details. You just don't even have time to process necessarily all of those things. And we love you, and it's really hard to leave this church in that way. I think we really praise the Lord that he has actually shown us what our next kind of job and calling is. And so I'm going to be working at Mission Church in Lancaster, Pennsylvania. This is the same church that I worked at for like 9 months and then planted the little church out of in 2008. And so I'm familiar with who they are, kind of church they are. Their senior pastor is my best friend in life. And so there's a bit of excitement about all of that, of course. And I honestly did not think that we would know what we were doing before we left Malaysia. Mm-hmm. And so again, this is just another way that God has been faithful. Like he's already kind of showed us that picture. And while we're not rushing into starting that job, we're going to take a couple of months to kind of do that. At the same time, that's a little bit exciting to actually already know that thing and to know what we're going to do. So I'm going to serve at this church, and I'm supposed to help develop their leadership training school that they want to start, and they're what they're going to call Mission Network and their next church planting efforts. And that's kind of a unique thing, just that I kind of feel like that's the kind of thing I want to do.
You want to do,
So, so if I'm not going to be the pastor of this church, I guess that's what I want to do. That's kind of where we're at in that whole process. So
that's kind of cool. I kind of leans into what you were saying earlier about God's faithfulness too, right?
Totally.
And reminds me of the verse. I can't remember verses very well, but just the whole idea that you start a good work and bring it to completion.
Totally.
And I love when Larry preached to talk about Jesus saying, let us go to the other side.
Yeah.
You know, and that really impacted me because it says that, hey, God already said he's going to take you to the other side. Now trust him in the journey to get there. You know?
Such a good word.
That's so cool to kind of reflect. We thought we'd just get into a bit more personal questions here before we get into the preaching of God's word or sharing of God's word.
Yep.
When the elder advisory board looked at the whole situation and came to the conclusion that for us, the best way forward for Harvest KL was to let the Newell family go and John go, how did you guys take that as a family or embrace that as a family? What was that like?
Well, you mean after we yelled and screamed and cried all night?
right.
I guess... because we were part of the decision-making process, there was a sense that we knew it was the right thing, but it wasn't what we wanted.
Right.
And so it was heartbreaking because it's that thing where, you know, this is the best thing for this church. This is the right thing for this church, but it's not what I want.
Right.
I always envisioned that we would be here 15 or 20 years. I never thought that we would be here for a lifetime. That doesn't really happen in the world anymore. But just that we would do this for a longer stretch of time than these 6 years have been. So so there's been, you know, so basically all the emotions from being angry to being sad to, you know, just being unsure and confused and scared.
Yeah.
At the same time, hopeful because this is the Lord's doing. And so even in the verse you talked about earlier, Acts 17, again, I think it's like 26, where Paul's preaching in Athens and he says that the Lord has determined the times and the boundaries for all people so that they would seek him. And like if we believe that verse is true, and I do, then the Lord has set these boundaries up for us, and so that people would seek him and that his sovereignty would demonstrate who he is. And so in the midst of all the emotions that are all over the place, there's just kind of this confident steadiness, like God is in control. And again, this isn't how I do it, but wow, he's way wiser than I am. And so apparently me leaving is actually a really good thing. And that's okay.
Yeah.
And he'll take care of us. He'll take care of this church. And we can trust him in that. And so that's kind of a progression of a journey that, you know, I'm able to say that now, but that wasn't like in the instant of those things. That's not how we saw it.
Yeah.
It's taken, you know, time and we've had to really wrestle with the Lord to get to the spot where we can kind of, I don't pretend to know the mind of God, but we can kind of see a picture of what he's doing in the midst of this. And yeah, praise God for that.
I think as a family too, you know, we had always said to the kids that we would be here for as long as the Lord allows.
Yeah.
You know, because as we moved different places, they'd always ask, like, how long are we going to live here? How long, you know?
Yeah.
And so I think it was just falling back on that. We've been here as long as the Lord allowed. And we are so thankful for that time. And then just, I mean, for me as a mom, it was hard to, like, I felt like we were walking off a cliff and that our kids were having questions that we didn't know the answer to right away. But that God is writing their story too.
Yeah.
He has a story for our family. We can rest in that and allowing each of us to grieve. Like we've loved it here, and that's an answer to prayer, you know, and then being able to just kind of reflect on the gifts of that, and that God has been faithful in making this our home, and he's gonna provide home again.
Right.
We have home with him.
That's awesome. Yeah, that's great. And thanks for sharing that. What's your hope for Harvest KL moving forward? What would you say your hope is for Harvest KL?
So I think one of my greatest hopes is just that Harvest KL would continue to be a place where every person, every nation is welcome. And God gets to shape what that looks like in every season, you know? But just that it's always a place that welcomes the gospel being spread, taught, shown to people from every tribe and nation. And then I think just in that it would remain a gospel light, you know, a gospel outpost here in KL. And and leaning into others in this city that are that as well. You know, yep. I've treasured the relationships with Gospel City Network and just that I think it's beautiful here in Kuala Lumpur that, you know, and that there's wisdom and there's others walking alongside of just that can help all of us continue in that gospel focused journey. Yeah. So.
Yeah, in a lot of ways, the answer doesn't change. My leaving doesn't change the answer to this question. Yeah, you know, like, what do I hope for this church? I hope this church always is looking to glorify God. Mm-hmm. I hope that this church is always seeking to obey Christ's command to make disciples. Mm-hmm. I hope this church is always learning how, because it's a continual process, growing to learn how to live loved and sent, and really none of that changes. That my hope is that all of those things continue to be the same in that, and everything that Marie said there as well. But
and then it passes all our hopes too. You guys,
absolutely. Yeah. And again, that there's no that we wouldn't hold that back in any way.
Sure.
You know, like that would be something that people would embrace and strive for together, with or without us.
Right. And kind of the last question here, what do you think God is teaching you and your family in this season of your lives?
A lot of things.
Yeah. I think the word for me is just to abide.
Yeah.
Which I picture that just of holding his hand, you know, as we walk through things that are both filled with joy and moments to treasure, and also things that are really hard or just stumble through what's unknown. So I think he's teaching me to abide as a mom, you know, and abide as a wife, and just also just me as a person to abide in the things that I thought would be different about my own personal, you know, journey or future or ministry. So
I think for me, it's that we would truly understand the power of the presence of God, and that's what I want to even bring us to a greater understanding from God's word here in just a moment as well, that we would learn to celebrate Immanuel, and so I want to explain that a little bit more in detail. But you know, in all of this, we're just, even as we kind of do this little interview, just so grateful for God allowing our lives to intersect, each of you here at Harvest KL. And for some of you, it's been almost all 6 years that we've been here. For the others of you, it might have only been the last 6 months, and we've hardly even seen each other in person in a sense. But we just have such a great love for you. And we want you to know we're always, we always support you and as a church. And while the Lord is definitely moving us to a different part of the world and to some different assignment, a different station in life, and that's completely unexpected. His presence is going to be the most significant thing about us. And I remember a mentor of mine said, you know, the most important thing is God's favor on us. And so actually I want to teach a little bit about that here, but in the process, just want you to know we love you so much, and we look forward to how God is going to shape you and mold you and use you as he builds his church here at Harvest KL. It's his church, and so we're happy to be assigned to however he wants us to be in that fashion.
That's fantastic. Yeah. All right, church, we hope you've been encouraged by some or been able to learn from some of Pastor Nate and Marie's and the Newell family's journey. We're going to transition into a time of hearing God's word being preached and shared, and I'll pass it off to Pastor Nate, so we'll transition there now.
Well, I'm so glad that I get to explain God's word to you one more time while I'm in the official capacity here at Harvest KL. This is, in a sense, a little bit of a farewell, but I get to continue to provide preaching in the coming months as well on a regular basis. And so I'm excited that I get to do that as well. But in the midst of this, I wanted to have one more time to talk a little bit from our series called It's a Boy. We've been celebrating the birth of Jesus Christ through our Christmas season here. And while this is a few days after Christmas, there's a text of scripture that I want us to see, and not just as a Christmas time event, but as something that we should see all year round as well. And so if you have your Bibles, look at Matthew chapter 1. And in Matthew chapter 1, there's just a couple of verses that provide a little bit of confusion, perhaps, and that I would like to give some clarity to, because the clarity is the thing that really helps us to understand an important, very important concept. I would say the most important thing that we need to know as believers. And so if you look at the story in Matthew chapter 1, we see how the angel appears to Joseph starting in verse 18, and just kind of all the information that he's getting from the angel. It says in verse 21, "She will bear a son, and you shall call his name Jesus, for he will save his people from their sins." So that's pretty obvious, right? He's told by the angel to call this little baby boy Jesus. And we know why. Jesus, because he's going to save his people from their sins. You see, when an Israelite man gave a name to his baby, particularly the baby boy, first boy, the name had significance. The meaning was really important. And so to see that Jesus means saving people from their sins is incredibly important. But if you go on, you see that that in verse 22 it says, "All this took place to fulfill what the Lord had spoken by the prophet." In Isaiah chapter 7, verse 14, it's quoted here in verse 23 of Matthew, "Behold, the virgin shall conceive and bear a son, and they shall call his name Immanuel." So does anybody have a little bit of a concern there? Like, wait a second. The angel says, call him Jesus. And yet the word of God says that all of this fulfilled what the prophet said. And the prophet said that they're going to call his name Immanuel. That seems like two different things. And if you were just to be quickly reading, if you weren't really a student of the Word of God, you would think that there's just some sort of something weird is happening here, that maybe the Bible doesn't agree with itself. And that actually what I want to show you is how important it is to see, how do we merge those two names together? Is that really what is supposed to be going on here? And so I was thinking a little bit about this concept here this morning, and you actually have to go all the way back in Israel's history to when they first found salvation. The Old Testament salvation story, the Old Testament gospel, is the Exodus. You remember how the people of Israel were taken into Egypt, and God used that time period to incubate them and make them into a very numerous and strong nation. They were enslaved there for 400 years. They hadn't heard from God. And then God, at the beginning of the book of Exodus, we hear him reveal himself to the people and begin to show himself that he's going to lead them out of Egypt and to the promised land. And so actually what we see here is in the story and in the telling of this, in Leviticus chapter 26, we have a really important statement. Leviticus 26, verse 13, actually verse 11, it says, "I will make my dwelling among you." Now, it's going to be important that you understand the word dwelling, and that God dwells, his presence. We're going to be talking about this over and over. "I'm going to make my dwelling among you, and my soul shall not abhor you, and I will walk among you and will be your God, and you shall be my people. I am the Lord your God who brought you out of the land of Egypt, that you should not be their slaves, and I have broken the bars of your yoke and made you to walk erect," or upright. And so God says here, at the beginning, in the telling of the story of what happened, that I'm going to be the God who dwells with you. Now, this is important because in Exodus, this is Leviticus, okay? But in Exodus, we hear the story and how that goes on. And in Exodus chapter 19, verse 4, he says, this is when he first introduces himself to Israel on Mount Sinai. He says, You yourselves have seen what I did to the Egyptians and how I bore you on eagle's wings and brought you to myself. I mean, this is so tender, and this is so soft, and this is so important that as God introduces himself to his people, he says, I bore you on eagle's wings and brought you to myself. Now, that's actually exactly what we hear all over the story of the Exodus and the telling of it. And Moses, at the very end of his life, when he gives a big speech to Israel, it's recorded in the book of Deuteronomy. In Deuteronomy 4, verse 37, he says it this way. He says, and because he loved your fathers and chose their offspring after them and brought you out of Egypt with his own presence by his great power, God tells us, I brought you out of Egypt with my presence. You see, the presence of God becomes incredibly important. It becomes the most important thing. And that's even true today. And so when we hear that at the beginning, the angel says, name him Jesus, he's going to save people from their sins. And the prophet says, but his name shall be called Immanuel, which means God with us. We begin to see how those two concepts, they potentially have some touch points that go together in an incredibly important way. And what we see is that in the story of Exodus, those two things merge in a powerful way. Let me tell you the story here a little bit. He says this, remember in Leviticus 26, he said, I'm going to make my dwelling among you. The word dwelling actually literally, I'm going to tabernacle among you. Now that's an important thing because this tabernacle was this place where they were going to construct a portable tent while they were in the desert before they would build a temple. And the tabernacle was where God's presence was going to be among the people. So when God promises that I'm going to dwell among you, it was going to be in the tabernacle. So God says to Moses, hey, come up the mountain. I want to tell you how the tabernacle is supposed to be built. And so while Moses is up there, he's actually up there for an incredibly long time. And while he's up there, the people begin to get impatient. And as God is telling him the law, the Ten Commandments on the tablets, and how the tabernacle was to be built, the people got so impatient that they began to make a brand new religion, if you will. Israel disobeyed. They were not patient. They were impatient. And they made a whole new religion. They made a substitute religion, if you will, that they were going to go into the land without Moses even. He was up there. They thought they'd kind of lost him. And so they were just going to build their own religion and go into the land while Moses was getting the details about how God was going to dwell among them. And so when Moses hears, God says to him, hey, you should see what the people are doing. He comes down the mountain and he's so upset, he throws the tablets and breaks them, right? You know that story? And in the midst of that, the first thing he has to do is put down a rebellion. And so he says, who is on the Lord's side? And you would expect this is God's people, this is Israel. They would all say, we are. But actually, hardly anybody does. It's only the tribe of Levi, who Moses is actually from, that says that we're on the Lord's side. All the other 11 tribes, they don't say they're on the Lord's side. And so Moses has to put down a rebellion. It's one tribe against 11. He actually has to go to war with the nation at that point. And in the midst of that, God says to him, these people have sinned so badly, so wickedly, that I cannot actually dwell among them anymore. So in Exodus 32, we hear the story of the substitute religion and the golden calf that Aaron makes for them. And the Lord says to Moses, go down to the people. They've turned aside. They've made a golden calf in verse 8. And the Lord said to Moses in verse 9, I have seen this people, and behold, it is a stiff-necked people. And that's the reason that God says, I can't dwell among them. He says, they're a stiff-necked people. Now, therefore, let me alone that my wrath may burn hot against them, and I'm going to consume them in order to make a great nation out of you. And he says to Moses, I'm going to make a nation out of you. I'm going to destroy all of them. God says, I can't go in the midst of them any longer. I can't be in their presence any longer. And Moses prays and he asks God to find another way. And God does actually find another way. He finds a substitute way. He actually says, and really the most important part of this is at the end of the chapter here, we see that God says that the angel of the Lord, who is God himself, will go before the people, but he won't dwell in the midst of the people any longer. Now, that seems like a solution, but it's so devastating. It's so sad. God, who has said to the people at the beginning, I'm going to dwell among you, you're going to be my people, I'm going to be your God, is now saying, because of your stiff-necked nature, because of your sinfulness, I can't dwell among you anymore. I'll go before you, but I can't dwell among you. And actually makes an arrangement where Moses goes outside of the camp of the nation of Israel, goes far off from the camp to a tent of meeting that is set up where God meets with him. God comes to the door and speaks to Moses in that place because he can't be in the midst of the people because his anger burns hot against them because of their stiff-necked nature. So God agrees and he makes a way, and in a sense, he brings forgiveness. So this is the whole idea of that God will forgive people their sins. Like, that's an awesome concept. That's an amazing concept. But what we see here is he does far more than just forgive us our sins. So the story goes on here, and Moses is meeting in this tent, and he pleads to God in Exodus chapter 34, and he asks God for two things. He asks God to reveal his name to him, which it's interesting, that name had already been revealed. The angel of the Lord said his name was Yahweh, his name was God himself. And so Moses already knew that, but he's asking for that to be revealed again. And then he makes this incredible prayer. He makes this incredibly beautiful prayer in Exodus chapter 34, verses 8 and 9. He says this, Moses quickly bowed his head toward the earth and worshiped, and he said, if now I have found favor in your sight, O Lord, please let the Lord go in the midst of us. You see, Moses is asking for the presence of God to dwell in the middle of them again. And then he gives the reason why he's asking God. And it's fascinating what his reasoning is. I mean, this is such a beautiful prayer. Remember how God said, I can't be in the midst of them because of the stiff-necked nature of these people, the sinful nature? Moses says the very same thing. He says, O Lord, please let the Lord go in the midst of us, for it is a stiff-necked people, and pardon our iniquity and our sin, and take for us for your inheritance. Moses goes to God in this amazing prayer and says, the very reason we need you in our presence is because we are sinful and we need to be forgiven of our sins. Do you see the beauty of that? We see here that God is saying, or Moses is saying to God, would you please tabernacle around among us because we desperately need your presence. Really, it's the turning point of the book of Exodus, the story of Exodus. Because from here on out, actually the heading over verse 10 in your Bible probably says, the covenant renewed. God said, behold, I am making a covenant before all your people. I will do marvels such as not been created in earth or any nation, and all the people among whom you are shall see the work of the Lord, for it is an awesome thing that I will do with you. God says, I am going to forgive you. And he says to Moses' response, I am going to be with, in the midst of the people again. I will renew my covenant with because of forgiveness. I will renew my covenant in that way. It's so important that you see how vastly important it is that God dwells in the midst of his people. That it's his presence that is the most important thing in this world. The absolute most important thing. And so God says, I'm not just going to lead you out of slavery, but I'm going to forgive your sins so that I can dwell with you. Do you see how, man, that sounds an awful lot like the New Testament, but this is the Old Testament. Do you see, that sounds an awful lot like grace. And it's right in the midst of the Old Testament story, right in the midst of the gospel, the greatest gospel story in the Old Testament. And what we're seeing here is that this is God consistently showing his character. He never changes, consistently showing his character all throughout Scripture. And what we see here is that when God sent Jesus to earth, Remember what Jesus said right before he died about himself in the temple? He said, I'm going to destroy the temple, and in 3 days I'm going to raise it back up. And really what Jesus is saying there at that moment is he's equating himself. He's saying, my body is the tabernacle. My body is the place of God's presence. And he's identifying his body as this tabernacle, which is so important because of what John says in John chapter 1. Are you familiar with John chapter 1, verse 14? John 1:14 says that the word, he begins with the whole idea of the word, and the word is the logos, and he's talking about who Jesus actually is. And then he says in verse 14, and the word became flesh and dwelt or tabernacled among us. It's interesting, John actually uses, he's actually using the reference back into the book of Exodus where God reveals his name and he says, I'm Yahweh, full of grace and truth. And John, using that reference, says that the word, Jesus, became flesh and dwelt, tabernacled among us, and we have seen his glory. Glory is of the only Son from the Father, full of grace and truth. In John, it's being revealed that Jesus is God and that he's present with us. He's dwelling among us. He has put on flesh and dwelt with us in this way. He's tabernacling with us, tabernacling with us. And so we begin to see then how the two names in Matthew actually are referring to the same thing. They're referring to the God who has always said, I will bring you out of slavery and I will free you from that and I will forgive your sins. I'm going to save you from your sins. That's Jesus. And then I'm not just going to save you from your sins and let you go do whatever you want. I'm going to be with you. My presence is going to be there with you. Immanuel, God with us. God is not just a deliverer of his people, he abides with his people. Our theme this year in 2020 has been abide. We've done most of the work out of John 15 and how important it is to remain attached to the vine of Jesus Christ. But the reason it's so important to be attached to the vine of Jesus Christ is because he is the one who saves and the one who dwells among us. His presence is among us. He is the one who put on flesh and is full of the glory, who is God himself in that way. So in terms of covenant relationship, we see here that God, listen, he saves. That's the greatest message ever. But the greatest reality is he doesn't just save, he's with us. It's his presence that matters the most. So I've been learning quite a bit about God's presence recently. I've been, this year has been one big lesson about God's power in presence. We couldn't have known that things were, that usually make us too busy to notice and treasure God's presence, were going to be ripped away from us by COVID. We haven't been to church to be able to worship together and to hear each other's voices singing and to greet each other. We haven't done that since March, but we've discovered a sweetness as well as some of the difficulty, I would say. But there's this sweetness of being able to worship God and to be fully focused on him instead of everybody that would normally be around us when we worship. I know for many of you, I know my kids have experienced school online and then in person and back and forth, and we've had MCOs and stuck at home and then back to the office and then back to stuck at home. In all of this, we've been forced to be still and had the opportunity to know who God is. And in our, even in my discovering that really the only viable option for Harvest KL to have a long-term sustainable future was going to be in my leaving, I felt this incredible heart-wrenching tear within me. But in it, I discovered that when God gives us a dream, and then he shows up and he brings it to life, but then that dream dies, that God is trying to find out what is more important, the dream or him. C.S. Lewis said it this way, he who has God and everything else has no more than he who has God only. Because God is infinite and infinitely capable of meeting all of our needs, God's presence is really all that matters. Nothing plus God is not more than God alone. The greatest thing is God's presence. So no dream, no calling, no job, no relationship, no possession, no comfort is greater than God alone. Whatever loss we have felt this year, whatever we still are experiencing in that sense, remember we have the greatest thing. We have Immanuel, who is God with us. So let's receive his presence. Let's prepare him room to dwell. Let's truly celebrate and say, this is the greatest thing, and we're going to dedicate ourselves to live in light of that. Harvest KL, as I end my official time here as your pastor, I would just point you to the one thing that is the greatest treasure that we have. It is God's presence. Nothing else matters. Nothing else is more important. If we fix our eyes on that, we can be assured, that there is no harm that would befall us. There is nothing that can rip us from that presence. There's nothing, even if something were to happen to us in this world, we have eternity with him in that way. There is no greater thing. Let's pray and thank him for that even now. Heavenly Father, as we have seen here this morning, we see that your presence is the most important thing. Lord, I thank you that you're not just a God who saves us. You're not just Jesus, but that you are Immanuel, God with us. Lord, I think that that's a consistent theme that we've seen through Scripture. That's not just something new when Christ was born, but this was something that you have always exhibited among your people. Lord, there is no greater thing than to have your presence with us. And Lord, we know we fall far short of your glory. We do not deserve to be in your presence because of sin. So thank you, Lord, for sending Jesus who saves, who forgives, who brings us back into relationship with God. And then, Lord, thank you that we can experience the presence of God in our lives. Lord, would you help us to live in light of these things? Would you help us to, Lord, remind us, please? So many times we fall short of living in light of this reality. We live as orphans, not as dearly loved children. We live thinking that we are not in your presence when we in fact have access because of Christ. Lord, would you continue to change us? And then, Lord, would you just continue to build this church in the reality of your presence and in all that you have called us to as a result of that? Lord, I just ask your continued blessing for many years, for many generations, Lord, that you would continue to show us your glory, that you would continue to reveal your name through this group of people, whoever happens to be a part of this church and all the different versions of it. And God, would you just continue to make yourself greatly known according to your purposes. Lord, we love you. And the most important thing is your presence. Thank you for it. It's in Christ's name I pray. Amen.
That leads to the Halloween manger.
What a great way to bring our service here this morning to a close, just singing Immanuel, Immanuel, God incarnate here to dwell. And God has given us the greatest gift of all, His Son, Jesus Christ, who is dwelling in our hearts if you believe in Him, and that empowers us in our day-to-day living. We hope you enjoyed our service here today, even in our conversations with Pastor Nate and Marie. And as we bring things to a close and move forward a new season, we hope the light of Christ and the hope of Christ, the joy of Christ, will continue to guide us forward into this new season. Just to recap some of the announcements that we'll share on the front end, there's no small groups this week, we're taking a break, but we're also, as an elder group, trying to come together and figure out what small groups going to look like in 2021. In January, we'll do a one-hour session. We haven't really figured out the details, but we will share that with you and through your small group leaders in the coming days. So if you want more information, connect with your small group leaders on that, or email us at smallgroups@harvestkl.org. We're also going to transition now into a time of giving. There's three main ways that you can give if you come prepared to give. Number one is through the Malaysian bank account option. You can find all the details of the bank account currently on your screen. Number two is if you have a US bank account and want to give via that route, you can click on the link that is currently on the chat feature on the right of your screen. And lastly, if you have no access to option one or option two, you can always put some money aside in an envelope and pass it to us here at the church office in the Wisma Chinese Chamber on the 7th floor. We'd love to receive you and welcome you, as well as receive your faithful giving in those ways. In fact, speaking about giving, we just want to give you a quick update on care funds and how that's been utilized, particularly in the Christmas gift drive that we did in collaboration with Oasis People's Church. And this past week, last Saturday and Sunday, Pastor Happy and her crew went into six or so homes to celebrate Christmas with the urban poor community that is in there in Lembah Subang, and were able to distribute a number of gifts to a whole range of children. And we just want you to know that your contributions has enabled that effort to bear its fruit. And as a mark to just honor your generosity, Pastor Happy has freely given us access to some of the photos that they've taken. So why don't we turn our attention to the screen and see a compilation of different photos and just the joy that you have enabled to land on the hearts of children because of your giving. So let's have a look. We hope that's encouraged your hearts, just seeing the difference that you can make in the life of young children in terms of giving them a gift, but more so in embodying the generosity God has embodied to us by giving us His Son. And we hope and pray that you will continue to journey with us as we continue on this partnership with Oasis People's Church. So thank you so much for your contributions. Thank you so much for the various ways that you have impacted communities, not just here in Harvest KL, but also beyond. All right, and that's all that we have for us this morning. Once again, thank you for joining us. And always remember, as we look forward to a new year, with all its challenges and all its joy, the Lord is good, and He's faithful, and always know that you are loved and you are sent.
Light arrives and heaven opens. Holy Spirit, let us hear it. When you speak, the church awakens. We believe the change is coming. Holy Spirit, let us see it. When you speak, you scatter darkness. Light arise in heaven opens. Holy Spirit, let us see it. When you speak, the church awakens. We believe the change is coming. Holy Spirit, let us see it. Your name is power over darkness.
Believe and die.